seekers of weird and wonderful cinema. This is Vault of the Killer Bees, the place that celebrates genre films that lie just outside the mainstream, the films that are so bad they're good, and of course, the hidden gems. Now, since this is spooky season, as it were, I thought we would go ahead and kind of gently ease you into that season here at the Vault of the Killer Bees with a really great little film from Hungary, of all places. It's from 2015, and it is it's a Amelie-esque dark comedy with Japanese pop songs. And it is, of course, Liza, the Fox Fairy. Now, you're saying to yourself, probably, wait a second, Hungary? Japanese pop songs? How does this work? And much like a Reese's pumpkin cup, the two different tastes actually go great together. The plot of Liza the Fox Fairy centers around a elder care nurse, Liza, who is living in the house of Marta, a widow whose husband was Japanese. And when the husband passed away, Marta went back to Hungary and took with her various mementos of her time in Japan, including various photos and maps and books and legends. But one of the more entertaining things that she brought, at least to Liza, is a bunch of Japanese pop from the 50s. And not only did Marta actually bring the records back, but apparently she brought back the ghost of one of her favorite Japanese pop stars, and that is Tommy Tammy, played by David Sakurai. And it's great to see him. He's got this really sort of slick kind of 1950s, almost Buddy Holly-esque costume going on, and he breaks into out into song quite frequently during the film, and it's really great. Now, unfortunately, Marta has gotten to the point where she can't see Tommy, but Liza can, and in fact, actually, Tommy has taken a bit of a liking to Liza. And when Marta passes away, and Liza, in a very sort of Knives Out twist, actually inherits Marta's apartment, Tommy decides that, I will go ahead and finally put into place my scheme to make Marta mine forever and ever. And so Tommy goes ahead and actually lets Liza find a book of Japanese legends and folktales that Marta left behind in her belongings. And upon reading some of these folktales, Liza comes across the folktale of the Japanese Fox Fairy. And that is a tragic folktale of a young woman that actually has fallen in love with a mortal being. The young woman is actually a fox spirit who is posing as a young woman. And we see here a photo of Liza imagining herself as the Fox Fairy. Now, Tommy goes ahead and kind of subtly implants the thought in Liza's mind that maybe Liza is a fox fairy, because according to the legend of the fox fairy, anytime a fox fairy falls in love with a mortal, that mortal person is doomed, even if they are just sort of attracted to one another, the fox fairy and the mortal. And we see here in this photo, Liza is meeting with Henrik, and he is the nephew of Marta, and he's got some plans of his own, trying to woo and seduce Liza in order to get Marta's apartment for himself to offset some gambling debts. Now, because Liza and Henrik are kind of attracted to each other, and Henrik is trying to seduce Liza, Tommy's not going to have it, so he goes about setting up a series of various accidents for Liza's different suitors. She's got more than one, and he kind of, for lack of a better term, gaslights Liza into actually believing that she is a cursed fox fairy, for every one of her suitors ends up meeting a very sort of darkly comical, almost Adam family-esque end, with electrocutions and electrocutions, stabbings, all sorts of quote-unquote accidents. Now, I did say this film is Amelie-esque. Aside from the dark kind of subject matter, this film is really, really whimsical. I really, really enjoyed the interplay between the character of Liza, played by Monica Basai, and David Sakurai, who is Tommy Tammy. They actually have a series of different musical numbers where they pretty much go all out. They're doing dancing, and there's like a dance with a mop that Liza does along with Tommy, and he's always in his sort of lime green Buddy Holly-esque suit with that great microphone. And as soon as Liza, you know, puts on the tape recorder, boom, he appears and he's ready to go and ready to sing. Tammy is actually a bit of a trickster, as you could probably tell from my description of the movie. And so we're not really sure if he's truly malevolent or he is just sort of a kind of jealous spectral beau of Liza. But with all the dead bodies piling up around Liza, of course, the police are notified and they are on the case. But of course, they don't, you know, necessarily believe that Liza is a fox fairy. But these police are not, I mean, they're competent, but it is a dark comedy, so they are sort of a bit bumbling, but that just adds to the charm of the film. It is really, really nice as far as the tonality goes. There's nothing really, really scary about the movie, but it is spooky enough to be a great entry point into the spooky season. And it also sort of plays into kind of like an art house aesthetic. So if you have some friends that are not necessarily fans of art house movies or international movies, this would also be a great entry point into both of those for this movie. It's just, it's so wacky and weirdly wonderful. It's definitely a great hidden gem. It did come out in 2015, as I mentioned, but this is the first time that it's ever been available on Blu-ray worldwide, and that is through Cauldron Video. And I've got the box right here. It's Liza the Fox Fairy. Let's see if I can get this glare off. There we go. Liza the Fox Fairy. It's got some great special features. There's also a Fox Fairy Legend and Fairy Tales essay by author Kat Ellinger, which is really good. It's got a couple of music videos from the movie based on the songs, sort of behind the scenes and some storyboards. And this was put out by Cauldron Films and Liza the Fox Fairy, a film by Karoly Mizrostos. It's a really, really great sort of genre-bending kind of dark comedy, perfect for the beginning of spooky season. And I highly, highly recommend it. Now, before we go, real quick, considering Florida has gone through Hurricane Ian at this point in time, I decided to go ahead and just mention something real quick. There is a great little documentary out through Vinegar Syndrome called Blood, Guts, and Sunshine. It is a documentary about the history of horror made in Florida. And it's got some great interviews with Herschel Gordon Lewis and a piece about Bob Clark, who did Children Shouldn't Play With Dead Things, and Black Christmas, of course. And it's got some interviews with the some newer directors out of Florida, some of whom make films like Bloody Bible Camp and Death Escort Service instead of Escort Service. It's a really fun sort of documentary and a great sort of starting point if you want to go ahead and look into the indie horror scene in Florida. And I know that they would appreciate any support that they could get through this trying time. And with that, that does it for this episode of Vault of the Killer Bees. If you enjoyed it, please give us a like and a subscribe to Sci-Fi For Me TV and turn on that notification bell so you never miss another journey into the vault or any of our other wonderful programs over here at Sci-Fi For Me TV.
Copyright 2022 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi For Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.